everyone, this is Sonali. Thank you all for carving out some time for attending today's webinar on the episode 8 of the Business X Learning Series, Invest, Scale and Value. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. Request you to keep the questions within the scope of today's discussion and not to your personal business queries. I would now like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Gaurav Marya, Chairman and Founder of the Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, Sonali, and welcome friends and welcome to another edition of our series with Business X, which is on about different subjects. We every time take a new subject around investing, scaling, and how you value your business. So today is a scale. We're doing the third edition. We talked about how do you really start thinking about scaling your business? How do you really then create tools of your business to be ready for scale? And then, other situations. So today in next half an hour, what I will do is I will first refresh in terms of a quickly, maybe a 5-minute note for a lot of people who have not attended the earlier two, webinars. And any kind of webinar, I mean, you've not missed, because this is the 8th edition, you can go on a Facebook of Business X and see all the editions available there. So today, we're going to talk about scale. And I'll put up a very big differentiation, which I'm going to take in today's session. And because the audience Business X and Franchise India has is a lot of startups, a lot of early stage companies, even a lot of conventional businesses, which are now looking to change and look at their businesses differently. And especially, I think, on one side, whatever is going on in the world, there's a lot of economical crisis which is going on. But also we see there are many, many opportunities which are ahead of us in different sectors. And we see a very different mindset today to address these opportunities. And I feel that there is a very sharp line coming in now, what I call the traditional kind of businesses and the new age businesses. And we'll talk something on that today. And while, I have seen many, many businesses, I've consulted over 2,000 odd different businesses. And I feel that if I have to go back to whatever we did for these companies over the last 15, 20 years, my strategy would be significantly different today. And, something which we have told and done for these companies, I might not be advising them again because those strategies have no meaning left at this hour. So which means that the world has to really look at business models very, very differently. We don't have to look at business models in the same way. But let's go back and revisit quickly what we have really covered. So scale, as I define, is a by definition, is S stands for the broad strategy, the strategy which is evolving, is fresh every time. Then C stands for three things. One is culture, competitive advantage, and core competence. These are three things which I would say C stands for, unless and until your company has a strong culture, a competitive advantage, and you are having understanding very clearly where is your core competence. Don't go here and there. A stands for actionable plan and accountability. How do you really create a very strong actionable plan and also set what I call internal and external accountability? L stands for liquidity. Always you need to keep eye 6 months or 1 year advance how your liquidity is really flowing in or what kind of liquidity requirements would you have. And E stands for execution, which has to be seamless and perfect. So again, I will define when you start thinking about scale, put this definition in front of you. Strategy, C stands for culture, competitive advantage and core competence. A stands for actionable plan and accountability. And E stands for execution, which has to be seamless. And once you have this in mind, then you have to work on three P's, which is what I call the people alignment, process alignment, and performance alignment. So if you are able to align these three things, people alignment is very important. People have to be aligned with your idea to scale. If they are not thinking in the sync as you are thinking, you will never be able to scale that business. Process alignment is very important. Your internal processes have to be aligned with the scale which you're looking at. And I feel that if I have to rate, I would say 70% of very scalable ideas not able to scale purely from a process viewpoint. Because they start scaling, the people are aligned, Their even performance is aligned, but the processes are not aligned. 70% of failures I would give because of the lack of processes. And this is where one of the areas which I like a lot of these tech-based businesses, which are able to scale themselves because the process by nature is more aligned in their businesses. Then we also talked in the last edition, there are only three ideas when it comes to scale. And these three ideas, I do not sound a fourth idea. It's always about how do you get new markets? How do you get new products? And how do you get new channel? If you are able to find these three, then only you will be able to do that. And today, I think some of the answers are very, very certain. If you really want to do some answers are very clearly straightforward. Technology is no more an option. Technology has to be part of company design. Now, from a design viewpoint, there would be no company, I would say, which would not embrace technology for every aspect of their business. Almost every aspect of their business has to be technology enabled. And that's where only way you can scale that. So now this we did for two long episodes and we went into different strategies and so on and so forth. We also talked about, what are the strategies available for companies to really, when they're looking at developing these three, how do you develop your people mindset? How do you develop your processes? And how do you set accountability in the system by performance management and so on and so forth. Today, I will talk about a very different thing. I'll talk about, sometimes when we talk on business growth, we confuse between growth and scaling. This is one of the areas which we will talk today. So a lot of people really think that the growth and scale is same. In the communication, in the when we represent, we actually take these two things very, very similar. And most of the times, a lot of entrepreneurs would think that growing the business is same to scaling the business. And today we are going to talk about a big differentiation in both of them. And this differentiation, I would say, is something which is changing in the business environment. And for many years, I was astonished by seeing some companies who were able to scale so fast, and rather, multi-markets, multi-structures, and some conventional companies were not able to do that. While I come from a very old school, because I run a company called Franchise India, and Franchise India historically had businesses which are retail businesses, brick and mortar businesses, and so on and so forth. And every time, for us also, we were confused between scale and growth, and businesses meant very clearly how do you really take this and how do you multiply, your customer base and so on and so forth. So what is the difference? Let's go into the clearer difference of this. But before we even go further, there is a timing, there is a timing which is very clearly, and a lot of people ask, when is the time to scale and what is the time one should really look at it? And very interesting, Richard Branson has said, scale up is when you are ready. It's not when the opportunity knocks. So fundamentally is that there is no specific timing, which should be really taken and then scale up. It's more when you really find that you are, as an organization, as a mindset, ready to do it. And that's where it needs to be done. And so even if this crisis, I know a lot of companies, we are looking to this as an opportunity time to rather scale and take a bigger market share. So you need to really see another thing, which is very important, is that you need to really catch the wave. And there is a finer timeline on that also. So there is a, while when you see yourself ready, then you also have to see that which side is the wave. If it is a positive wave, then you need to really not waste the time. You need to go out and catch that. Now let's understand growth. The conventional companies, and most of the companies really mean growth. For them, growth means that if you want to grow their revenue, their market share, they would grow their resources or they would grow their costs. So it's very clearly revenue is proportionate to the resources deployed, which technically means that if I was McDonald's, growth would mean how can I add more stores? So every time you want a growth, you want to grow your top line, you would now have to multiply and invest into more stores to be deployed, more people to be hired, more infrastructure to be deployed, and so on and so forth. So fundamentally, it is very directly proportionate. And so companies continue to do quarter-on-quarter growth, quarter-to-quarter investment. So they keep balancing and keep managing their small profitability and whatever the business is. I think this is growth. This is very clearly a very conventional way to do that. Even my organization, there was a time where in 10 years back, we thought that we really want to grow. We were in six cities and we went into 70 plus cities in India. We went to 6 other countries. So idea was very clearly every month, my only objective was to tell my HR, how do we hire more people? Because every time I hired more people, it proportionately gave me a little more growth on my top line. And I can tell you, all goes well in this structure. They continue to do that. By the time the market has demand side, you will continue to deploy more resources, continue to deploy more in structure, and you'll be proportionate to your revenues would continue to grow. And if you don't miss your line, you will still be a profitable organization. The problem happens when this equality of revenue resource changes and your revenues don't come because the market has either shrunk or you're not able to capture more market or you're not able to convert and get the kind of optimization the deployed resources are not able to create. And this imbalance really starts because it is a very small margin. Most of the times they won on very neck to neck from your resources deployed to the entire thing. And that's why these conventional companies work on a 10, 12, 15% kind of a bottom line. And if for reasons, either inflation or you're not able to capture the next revenue cycles or there is slowdown like what we are passing through, this balance would change. So I have seen companies which were relatively doing well, like say if I were running a restaurant chain and suddenly my equation changed, my revenues dropped because a lot of people started doing delivery, like what happened through Delivery Zomato and Swiggy. A lot of these restaurant chains are not profitable and they would start closing down or coming down and so on and so forth. Now that's where conventional businesses think growth. Very clearly, if you ask any conventional business, what is your way of growth? You know, so they would say, oh, if I was a manufacturer, I would say, let me put more of additional facility, I'll produce more and so on and so forth. So every time it would deploy more resources and do that. Scale is on the other side, very different. Scale is all about how do you really able to, take, so the key difference between the scale is that is achieved by increasing revenue without increasing significant costs. So how can you increase significant revenue change in your business model and without having a similar kind of a cost structure? Rather, a minimalistic cost can increase significant value in the business. That's only way I think scale would come. So a lot of new age businesses, really speaking, are companies which are designed to scale. So one of the areas which is very important that when you really have to think over scale, over growth, you need to really go and revisit your business model itself and say, is the business model ready for it? Because the business model sometimes is not. Like, I mean, for example, if I want to really say that how McDonald's would do this, McDonald's would be able to still continue to scale and not have to deploy the same amount of investments which they do in the conventional structure. What different they would do. So sometimes a very conventional businesses are not able to find that answer. But when you have to really look at the companies which have become the top 10 companies of the world, which are able to multiply their revenues without significantly deploying in the equal ratio their resources, are the companies like a Facebook or a Google. You know, even people are in multiplying by without doing that. You continue to put a lot of data on Facebook, they are becoming enriched in the entire thing. So actually, they've got free copywriters, free these people who are anybody and everybody using these platforms are actually contributing to the platforms and the platforms are growing. So these platforms are designed to scale. The organizations are designed to scale. So a lot of companies, especially in India, I really see that they are not ready for it. Some tech platforms, some tech companies, yes. But a lot of other companies really have to ask that how can we scale? You know, how can we grow substantially and acquire a substantial amount of consumers without putting same amount of resources, because this old style of businesses are no more interesting in the business. So the two things which becomes a very important when you have to reconsider your organization, there are two things which needs to come in. One is innovation. How do you innovate now? How you look at the base, the overall business model? And second, what is the kind of a foresight capabilities you bring in within the organization? So if you are able to do innovation and foresight within your organization and relook your business model and ask yourself how you will do that. How do you be able to reach much more customers without putting the same kind of deployment? You know, the old school of doing things have significantly changed. And that's something which one has to really see that how you're able to do that. You know, any company which comes down to a point where there is a critical path have to be chosen. And when I say critical path would mean that if what should I do next? And if you're clearly seeing that I'm as an organization ready to really scale up, Second side is that you are also seeing a positive wave of your industry or your business model. Then you need to really take a call. What is a conventional way of growth is right, or I want to find a new way of scaling up without putting in time. So before you scale up, and this is one of the areas which really comes in when you early startup to a really time where you can be ready of a scale up. So it's a very different timing. Startup has a multiple other issues. Startup is not even commercially proven the product and so on and so forth. So I'd never say that you should even look at scaling up. You need to really go out and find yourself, your feet and stabilize yourself, and then only you can go to the next level. But for companies which are, so to say, reached that point where they actually have what I call the product is being tested in the market. They have also seen a commercialization and early success of the business model. They feel that there is an exponential growth available for their product or a service, and they also can attract a large amount of funding through Series A, B, and C, and so on and so forth, wherever they are. Then only I think the scale-up idea can really come in. So this is where you need to really ask yourself. So I call it a little bit of a checklist. How do you really bring in a checklist of is it time for you to really do that? So what I call, there's a thing called MVP. MVP is minimum viable product. So have you a viability of your product or a service which you want trying to do that has been achieved? Have your process development and management in place, which I told in the first edition also. How do you really you delve your process management and your development? And this another thing, which is third point, is the whole culture has to be very differently organized. When you're scaling up, you know, so if you really see organizational designs are what I call very clearly the freedom of decision making, so to say, rest with that senior guys or senior management, and they actually design a product and then give it to the last man, and the last mile person has very little freedom. It's actually much more controlled, and the freedom lies at the top and not at the bottom. So you have to turn around this structure. How can you turn around the structure that you give a little bit of freestyle at the front? So that a lot of customers, even to extend that it has the customization in the hands of the customer also. The customer can take a look. Otherwise, it'll slow down. If everything has to go back to the top and top has to take a decision, it's just choke. That's why these technology companies are great, because they give actually a freedom to a customer to really design the product. They don't even want this to be done. So they give a lot of freestyle at the front, more freestyle at the front and a control at the back from a perspective that you are able to just control that in terms of what is going on from a flow viewpoint, but you give a lot of freedom in the front. Otherwise, I think there is a lot of control at the front. You know, they don't allow things to change. Everything has to do that. And like older conventional style of businesses, like when we are in consulting business. So our consulting business works that a gentleman, our senior guy, a relative junior guy would go in the market, meet the client, and client tells you this. And if there is a change in the product, needs to be done, he will come back, reach out to his senior, the seniors will go to the next senior, depending on where the control really lies. This whole cycle can take to generate even one single proposal, which is customized to a client, can take 2 to 3, 4 weeks. And then the decision making. So the cycles of acquisition becomes 1 month, 2 months, 3 months kind of a cycles. It's all foolishness, right? How do you really change that? And how do you really build a structure where even a customer can design his own product, right? And this is how now I'm seeing a lot of design tools, learning tools, other things available where you can go and you can choose what you want, how much duration you want, whatever you want. So all the content companies are giving a lot of freedom to people. You know, so earlier days, this was not available for people. This was very, very slow. So scaling kind of never happened. So how do you really create a balance between a freestyle operations and bringing in controls? And also, another area of a checklist is that diversification sometimes becomes an idea of scaling, you know, which means that I can go to multiple things within the business, right? Like Oyo Rooms. Oyo, when they started scaling up, while they are a hotel management company, and they were going in multi-markets globally, and suddenly they started diversifying also. They wanted to be in co-working space. They wanted to be also in the banquet management space and things of that nature. Now, all those businesses, to my knowledge, have not done well for them. So they have to really understand where is the scalability, right? I mean, today there's a great company where I'm a big admirer. It's called Lenskart. It's an eyewear company, great scale. they've brought in the business because they're very O2O platform, which is online and offline kind of capabilities integrated, low inventory at a store level, very, very scalable idea. But now they can tomorrow say, if what we have done in eyewear, we can do in watches, we can do in something else, we can do in something else. And that's where they can go wrong. I feel that they have found the answer in the current category. Stay committed to your core competence. Don't overly diversify. Diversification cannot be an answer to scalability. It can be, in some sense, you have to, at a certain level, when you hit the what I call the three cycles of your scalability. One is what I call the growth, penetration, and saturation. As you start hitting saturation life cycle, then you probably have to look at some kind of diversification on your bottle, but not at the growth level, not even at the penetration level. And when you hit the saturation, that almost everybody who really wanted to acquire in this marketplace or a global marketplace, you've already done that, and then you need to now get into that thing, which is very clearly what Titan did. If you see, Titan was in watches for 10, 12, 15 years, stick closely, very clearly in watches. Then they start getting into eyewear. Then they're now into getting started in personal care, which is perfumes and things of that nature. So they every time give a full cycle to offer one category to completely mature, and then they open up another diversification on the business model. So similarly, I think they went from watches to jewelry, the jewelry to eyewear, and eyewear to perfumes now. So that's a cycle they've done, and almost every cycle has taken 8, 9, 10 years of a full maturity and saturation before they have really opened up another category to do that. And then also they really put all the systems, and that's why this company is so great. That's why Titan is a phenomenal organization. Another big difference in scaling up is that in the 3 to 5 year plan, if you don't see that there is going to be a growth in the in your revenues and your cost. Say you are starting today, your cost is at X, but your revenues is X plus. If next year you cannot go from a cost, say becomes X plus, then your revenues should become X plus plus plus. So fundamentally, if this substantially not growing year on year, then you will not build a huge value in the business model. And that's where it would then. So scale essentially means that on a year on year basis, the difference between your cost and your revenues would substantially increase. And that's where the value would be. If you are able to design these, so to say, 5 different checklists, then you are ready for scaling the business model. Now let's talk about 7 odd strategies, which I feel would work if you're looking for scaling your business. And the first strategy is, how do you really bring a repeat value in the same product or a service? If customers are renewing regularly with you, how does structure of renewal work in your business model? I mean, is the same effort required to get the same customer to spend the same dollar with you, or it is going to change, and how it can be changed? And I feel a lot of companies, especially service-based businesses, have to do the same efforts, same cost of acquisition to acquire the same customer. And that I don't think really is a good idea. First, you need to really shift the whole cycle, is that how do it becomes a repeat purchase value in the business model? Second strategy is what I call put a functional depth into business model. How do you really put a functional depth? And the functional depth comes from very clearly defining all the functions of your operations and try to make it automated. Almost every system of your business becomes extremely automated. One of the companies I'm getting very impressed, again, I'm saying, by Lenskart, because if you really use the user experience and you go there and the company, they have really automated almost every smallest principle of the entire user experience. From a user coming and telling that, look, I need a frame to have numbers of SKUs available to on the shelves, almost everything. Otherwise, there was a lot of challenges in the businesses, and the conventional businesses were so challenging. They don't have control over inventory. They don't know what is available in the real-time stocks. They don't have real-time inventories. They don't have the whole experience of acquisition to delivery to post-delivery relationship, and all that was processes are missing. So how do you really automate the processes, and how do you bring in strong functional depth in your business model? Strategy number 3, which is very, very important, how do you do, you know, bring intuition to your business model? And, you know, how do you do advanced intuition to your business model, that you really know what is customer going to do 6 months from now, 1 year from now, and so on and so forth. And so I clearly see that if you really want to understand the market need, then you need to build business intelligence. if you build a business intelligence on business intelligence, you can do your product development. And so your product change cycles could continue to run like that. So 5-6 months of building business intelligence and 5-6 months of a product to market kind of an opportunity. So when product development also runs from a very clearly 4 functions, which are classic functions: define the product, develop the product, operationalize, and launch. This is a very conventional structure of from actually defining what people need and how they need it to get development, to get operationalized, and then launch the product. But before, this was the only cycle which people used to do, but it was not based on critical data. Now the data has to have another cycle. There has to be a layer of business intelligence. And now there are a lot of companies actually coming globally who are business intelligence companies. They'll actually take all your data and give you all the data points you wanted. Because sometimes you are not able to churn your own data. You don't understand data. Look at companies which have large databases, telecom companies, insurance companies. They have phenomenal data. They don't have no understanding how they can churn that data, understand learnings from that. So they need to have a lot of good technology, business intelligence companies, which would really churn these data. And now these companies are reaching out to them and say, take our data. And their data was possessiveness. You know, they never used to share the data. But now banks are sharing the data. Everybody is sharing the data because they need to answer a lot of answers they don't know, where they can create future products on that. So how do you really bring strategy on that? Now, strategy number 4 is what I call the triple E. The triple E stands for how do you build consumer reach, your customer reach, through best of the efficiency, best of the effectiveness, and best of the engagement. So how do you really get your consumer reach with best efficiency? You don't have to push so much. It's so efficient to reach out. And that's where technology does it. Technology like Amazon, it has a best efficiency. You know, you have everything. It has a strong effectivity and it has a phenomenal engagement from when you bought the product, or even when you saw the product and wanted to make a decision, to really when you bought the decision and know the whole supply chain delivery cycle, when it reached you and post delivery, everything is so very well managed. So how do you really create this triple E in your consumer reach, from building efficiencies, building effectiveness, and engagement? I think that's strategy number 4. Strategy number 5 to me is the whole sales cycle. You know, how do you really do what I call the triple S? This is triple S from selection. Why should somebody choose you over anything? What is your selection process? Where are you being presented? How it is been selected? So selection to sales cycle to subscription cycle. How do you shift that? And this is where I'm getting impressed by companies. Like, I mean, we are using Zoom. You know, when I started using Zoom about 1.5 years back, it was free to everybody. It's still free. You can use about 40 minutes, but my reviews, I used to use it. When I used to use a review, most of the times reviews would go into 1 hour and so on. They critically know that good meeting would go beyond 40 minutes. It was very, very stupid to go back and do the entire thing. So I upgraded myself to a certain level and started using their pro line. And then this was unlimited. You can go into that. But still, now with the platforms now coming in, you need to do a lot of webinars. You have a large audience to bring in. Now, some of our platforms, we have many subscriptions of Zoom. Some of our platforms are 1,000+ people. There is one platform we use in our real estate network, which have 10,000 people. So depending on the need, which was continue to evolve and new things I wanted to do that, I'm continue to upgrade myself in that structure. So what they did was they gave me something to try on. So I tempted on selecting them. Then they shifted me to a sales function that I started paying with them. And I started recognizing the service was good. And now they're making a subscription. And they know that in a life cycle, I'll become a subscriber for Zoom. And if this is a new normal, and this is going to be 20 years, and next 20 years, me and my company would continue to pay Zoom multiple dollars and continue to upgrade the services and so on and so forth. And they would continue to understand what are the next level of requirements we need to have. Like these days, we use a lot of poll in this entire structure. So multiple other things would come in, depending on what is the ask now. What do we want to do? And these asks would be their continuous development structure. Like there are many tools now people use, a lot of learning, a lot of training. So you need whiteboards, you need this entire structure. So all that pieces would start coming in soon. And each piece, you will start subscribing more and more and more. So fundamentally, you start using the entire thing. So what they've done is that they move this triple S structure from selection to sales to making a subscriber. How do you really create that entire thing. And also, how do you really continue to build more value addition on the structure? Sixth strategy, which is a strategy I always believe in scale, you need to really do, which is how do you do multi-channel? How do you reach multi-channel? How do you reach multi-market, multi-product? So if you do all three together, then also apply these three things. And don't think about one. If you really want to scale, you need to really three, multi-channel, multi-market, multi-product. And then only scale would come. A seventh strategy is where I come from. And one of the industries which we have really popularized in India for the last 23 years is franchising. We feel that franchising is also a great scale strategy. Why? Because again, you don't put your own capital and you have a product or a service and you use your the most structured channel, which is franchise, and use franchising for say, scaling up the entire thing. That is a great strategy. It's been a classic strategy for many, many years companies have used. And that's why franchising becomes such a more powerful tool to really scale your business or scale your product or service. So this is what the difference was. Today's session was all about really about how do you really differentiate between a growth and a scale, and how do you really create strategies around it so that you are able to take the your business ahead. It's a good time. It's a good time to reinvent your business model and go back and really see how do you really would like to scale your business without putting substantial cost on books. And that's where the value is coming in. That's where I think a new age businesses are doing extremely well. And while old school businesses are struggling and they would continue to even struggle more in next 2 years, unless and until they revisit their entire business model again. So this is was the today series. We will obviously take up the next week. There is a session on value. We keep it 30 minutes. I think I've taken 5-7 minutes more. So it's normally a 30-minute capsule. And all the earlier seven capsules, this is the 8th edition, but all the 7 capsules are available on our Facebooks at BusinessX. You can go and visit. So every week we take one edition either on investing, scaling, or how to value your businesses. And we at BusinessX are a platform for companies, startups, entrepreneurs, business owners to either raise capital. So if you want to raise capital, you obviously can come to us and we can help you. Or if you want to really sell your business, a lot of businesses which want to take an exit, and both if you are profitable and if you're not so profitable businesses, you can come to BusinessX and we can help you get the right buyer. First, we help you to value your business. We have a separate vehicle called Biz Equity, which is a fintech product. How do we quickly value your business? And then we actually help you to sell your business. So over to you, Sonali. If you have any question for me, then I can be happy to take that.
Thank you so much for another wonderful session, Gaurav sir. It was a pleasure having you as always. And we do not have any major questions with us for today. So I would just like to thank you for your session. And I would also like to thank all the attendees for your time. We will see you next time, next Saturday at 3 o'clock for another session, as Gaurav sir said, on creating value in your business.
And if you are to have any question for me, and if you want to reach out to me, I will write my email ID. It's gm@gauravmaria.com. So please reach me if you have any thing which I can help you in your business, or if you feel that your business needs capital or needs franchising, licensing, any of our categories which franchising the group really works on. Thank you very much for your time, and thanks for joining us. Next Saturday, 3 o'clock, another session with BusinessX platform. Thank you.